Sometimes we know, sometimes we don't. Sometimes we give, and sometimes we won't. Sometimes we're strong, sometimes we're wrong.
Hey everybody, my last few videos have described verifying trigonometric identities which reflect equations which are always true. Now we want to consider trig equations, or more correctly, conditional equations, which are only true for certain values in the domain of our expressions. You can see some examples below. So let's start out easy to get a feel for what we're up against. Suppose we had an equation cosine x equals negative 1. Thinking of our unit circle, since cosine is equal to our x value, the only solution occurs at the point negative 1, 0, where our arc length is pi. So x equals pi is a solution. But if we kept going around the circle, we could also have 3 pi, 5 pi, or going in the opposite direction, minus pi, minus 3 pi, or any additional multiple of a complete wrap. These angles are all congruent to pi. We write this collection of answers in the form shown here. That is, x equals pi plus n times 2 pi, where n is assumed to be any integer value. You can see here that if n equals 0, we just get our original solution pi. If n equals 1, we add one full wrap and get 3 pi. If n equals minus 1, we wrap backwards and get minus pi. So this notation gives us every possible congruent solution. Another way to think about this equation is to think about the graph of y equals cosine x. We are looking for all the values of x where our graph hits the y value negative 1, which again will be at pi and repeat every period of 2 pi. Now suppose instead we had 2 sine theta plus 1 equals 0. We can solve this easily enough for sine theta and get sine theta equals minus 1 half. Since sine corresponds to our y value, we see from the unit circle that there are two distinct solutions having a reference angle of pi over 6. Hence theta equals 7 pi over 6, or theta equals 11 pi over 6. And then allowing for all our other congruent variations, we write theta equals 7 pi over 6 plus n times 2 pi, and theta equals 11 pi over 6 plus n times 2 pi. Here's one that will require a calculator. We start with 11 cosine x equals 7, so of course cosine x equals 7 over 11, which equals 0.63636. We can use the inverse cosine to solve this, and we get x equals the cosine inverse of 0.63636, which is 50.48 degrees. But we need to remember that the inverse cosine only gives us the single solution in the interval 0 to 180. We need to think of this as a reference angle on our unit circle, and observe that minus 50.48 degrees would also be a solution. And now to list all our other congruent solutions, we use our same trick, except this time we're using degrees instead of radians. So we write x equals 50.48 plus n times 360, or x equals minus 50.48 plus n times 360. Now that you have a handle on solving basic linear trig equations, that is, ones where the trig functions raise to the first power, let's consider some that are raised to a higher power. We can treat these the same as we do polynomial equations. Hence, we'll try to factor the expression, such as 9x squared minus 1 equals 0 below, and then use our zero factor property to break this up into separate linear equations. Consider 4 sine squared x minus 1 equals 0, which can be factored into 2 sine x minus 1 times 2 sine x plus 1 equals 0. Then we break this into the separate linear equations, which give us sine x equals 1 half and sine x equals minus 1 half. We just need to take this one step further and solve these as we did our last few examples. So sine x equals 1 half gives us x equals pi over 6, or x equals 5 pi over 6, and sine x equals minus 1 half gives us x equals minus pi over 6, and x equals minus 5 pi over 6. And of course we can add n times 2 pi to each of these for all possible solutions. How about the equation 2 cosine squared equals cosine x plus 1? If we think of substituting y for cosine x, this just becomes 2y squared equals y plus 1, which is a quadratic equation. We're going to treat this the same. Taking everything to one side, we get 2 cosine squared x minus cosine x minus 1 equals 0, which we can factor into 2 cosine x plus 1 times cosine x minus 1 equals 0. Now we can break this apart as 2 cosine x plus 1 equals 0 and cosine x minus 1 equals 0. And we can solve both these for cosine and get cosine x equals negative 1 half where cosine x equals 1. On the unit circle, our x values equal negative 1 half at 2 pi over 3 and 4 pi over 3, and cosine x equals 1 when x equals 0. Now to include all our congruent angles, we just add n times 2 pi. If you notice the symmetry of our three solutions, you might realize we could actually combine these into a single expression. We let x equal n times 2 pi over 3. If n equals 0, then x equals 0. And adding multiples of 2 pi over 3 just moves us from one solution point to the next. We may also think of this problem graphically. If the right and left-hand sides are considered as separate graphs, then we're asking, when will the graph of y equals 2 cosine squared x and the graph of y equals cosine x plus 1 intersect? We can see that our analytic solution matches up with the graphical one. That is, every multiple of 2 pi over 3, our graphs intersect. Or equivalently, we could have moved everything to one side and considered finding all the zeros of the graph y equals 2 cosine squared x minus cosine x minus 1. Here's a slightly different problem we can solve by factoring. Secant alpha cosecant alpha equals 2 cosecant alpha. By bringing the cosecant over to the left-hand side, we now have a common factor of cosecant alpha, so we can factor this out. This gives us cosecant of alpha times secant alpha minus 2 equals 0. Breaking these apart, we get cosecant alpha equals 0, or secant alpha equals 2. Cosecant equals 1 over sine alpha, and since this fraction has a 1 in the numerator, it's never equal to 0. Hence, our first expression provides no solution. Our other equation gives us 1 over cosine alpha equals 2. If we invert both sides, we get cosine of alpha equals 1 half. This gives us alpha equals pi over 3 plus n times 2 pi, or alpha equals minus pi over 3 plus n times 2 pi. How about sine 2x equals 0? Well, one way to solve this would be to use our double angle identity, which gives us 2 sine x cosine x equals 0. We can break this apart as sine x equals 0 or cosine x equals 0. This gives us the four points of intersection of the unit circle with the x and the y axis. Because of the symmetry, we can combine these into the single solution, x equals n times pi over 2. However, there's another way to solve this problem that's useful in a number of difficult situations. That is to think about making a substitution, say phi equals 2x. Now we only need to solve the problem sine of phi equals 0. This gives us phi is equal to 0 plus n times pi. Then we can substitute back for phi and get 2x equals 0 plus n pi. And to solve for x, we multiply both sides by 1 half. This gives us x equals 0 plus n times pi over 2, which agrees with our previous result. So now consider the problem tangent 4x equals 1. You would not want to try to use identities to expand this out. Instead, we can easily let theta equals 4x and then solve tangent theta equals 1. This has the easy solution that theta equals pi over 4 plus n times pi. We only need n times pi because tangent has a period of pi. Now substitute back in 4x for theta and multiply both sides by 1 fourth, and we get x equals pi over 16 plus n times pi over 4. This trick's not limited to just multiples of angles. We can use the same trick for, say, 2 sine x plus pi over 6 equals negative 1. Solving this for sine, we get sine of x plus pi over 6 equals negative 1 half. And now we can think about letting theta equal x plus pi over 6, and we have sine theta equals negative 1 half, which we can easily solve to get theta equals 7 pi over 6 plus n times 2 pi, or theta equals 11 pi over 6 plus n times 2 pi. And then, like before, we substitute x plus pi over 6 back in for theta. And to get x by itself, we subtract pi over 6 from both sides, leaving us with x equals pi plus n times 2 pi, or x equals 5 pi over 3 plus n times 2 pi. Let's return to using identities. This next problem, sine of x plus pi over 3 plus sine of x minus pi over 3 equals 1, looks similar to the last one, but because one of them is adding and one of them is subtracting, we can't make a single substitution. In this case, using an identity is our best path. We have an identity for the sine of the sum or difference of angles. Applying this formula, we replace sine of x plus pi over 3 with sine x cosine pi over 3 plus sine pi over 3 times cosine x, and sine x minus pi over 3 with sine x cosine pi over 3 minus sine pi over 3 cosine x. This gives us 1 half sine x plus square root of 3 over 2 cosine x plus 1 half sine x minus square root of 3 over 2 cosine x equals 1. The cosine terms cancel, and 1 half sine x plus 1 half sine x is just sine x, so we're left with sine x equals 1, and this we can easily solve to get x equals pi over 2 plus n times 2 pi. Here's another equation which is best solved using one of our identities. Sine of 5x plus sine of 3x equals 0. In this case, we can use our sum to product formula to convert this into a product. We get that the sine of 5x plus sine of 3x equals 2 times the sine of 8x over 2 times cosine of 2x over 2, which equals 2 times the sine of 4x times the cosine of x. Since this product equals 0, we can break it apart as sine of 4x equals 0 or cosine of x equals 0. We could substitute for 4x or just say that 4x equals 0 plus n times pi, which gives us x equals n times pi over 4. Cosine of x equals 0 gives us x equals pi over 2 plus n times pi, but these solutions are already included in the previous list, so our solution reduces to just x equals n times pi over 4. Let's finish with a few applications. For our first example, we have a baseball player throwing a ball from outfield to home plate. The horizontal distance the ball travels depends on the initial velocity and the initial angle. The equation is shown below. If the ball is thrown with an initial velocity of 75 kilometers per hour, what angle should the outfielder use if it's 100 meters to home plate? In this equation, v is our initial velocity, which is 75, and d is 100 meters, so we only need to solve this for theta. We get that 100 equals 75 squared over 32 sine 2 theta, which equals 175.781 sine 2 theta. Hence, the sine of 2 theta equals 0.56888. 2 theta is then equal to the sine inverse of 0.56888, which is 34.87 degrees. So theta is equal to 34.67 over 2, which equals 17.335 degrees. If you saw the movie Hidden Figures, you might recognize this equation from the chalkboard behind Jerusha Henson, who is playing Katherine Johnson.
33 degrees west, which is here. Give or take 20 square miles.
I like your numbers.
In our final example, we have two lines. One has the equation x plus 2y equals 20, while the other goes through the origin and makes an angle theta with the x-axis. The area of the blue shaded triangular region depends on the angle theta, and a formula for the area is given below. What choice of theta would result in an area of 50 square units? Substituting 50 for A, we now have an equation in the single variable theta. We can multiply both sides by cosine plus 2 sine to get rid of the fraction. Now we have 50 cosine theta plus 100 sine theta equals 200 sine theta. Subtracting 100 sine theta from both sides leaves us 50 cosine theta equals 100 sine theta. This may look odd, but we can write this in terms of a single function if we divide both sides by cosine theta. Let's do 100 cosine theta. Then we're left with tangent theta equals 1/2. Hence, theta is equal to the tangent inverse of 1/2, which is 26.565 degrees. Hopefully this is enough to get you started solving trig equations. You can see more of my math videos at www.mathforeveryone.info. Please feel free to leave comments and suggestions, and thanks for watching.
Well, we're gonna have to sit down and think it through. If we're only human, what more can we do?
All things being equal, I'd rather be in Philadelphia.